Hello out there, guys. Welcome back to the channel. I am back with another video and I'm really excited to have a previous guest back on the show, which we'll get into in a minute. But before we do, guys, don't forget to like, subscribe. Also, I am walking the YouTube tightrope, let's put it that way. So I really would recommend you subscribe to my other channels over at Bitchute, Odysee, Rumble, and my backup channel, which I will put links for in the description, and also the Telegram group as well that I also have, because the rug could get pulled at any moment now. I am walking on thin ice. So with that being said, we have got the wonderful Jerry Marzinsky back on the channel. Just a brief introduction about Jerry. Jerry is a retired licensed psychotherapist with over 40 years of experience working with and studying the thought processes of psychotic and criminally insane patients in some of the most volatile psychiatric institutions in the nation. Jerry is a commercial pilot, certified scuba diver, and long distance motorcyclist. He has held the position of second lieutenant in the Arizona Civil Air Patrol and assistant scout master. He was awarded the State of Arizona's Meritorious Service Award and the Pima College Apple Award of Teaching Abnormal Psychology. His formal academic training comprises a BA in psychology from Temple University, a master's degree in counseling from the University of Georgia, and 2 years of study in a PhD psychology program. He is the co-author of An Amazing Journey into the Psychotic Mind, Breaking the Spell of the Ivory Tower, and he currently has a private practice in Arizona. Jerry's website is jerrymarzinsky.com, and I will put all his other links down in the comments and the description link below. So without further ado, Jerry, how's it going, mate?
It's going. I'm in YouTube jail also. so we're cellmates.
We're in the naughty corner. So
they threw me out for longer than they threw you out. You got a couple of weeks. I got 6 months.
Yeah. Like I say, I'm surprised I'm still up after all these years. But it is what it is. You know, we're in full spiritual warfare right now, well, physical and spiritual. And you know, it really just. It just shoots them in the foot, I think, because when they do that to people, it just credits everything that they say. It gives that person more credit. It makes you believe them more when they do that. So I don't know why they do that, but it is what it is. But Jerry, I wanted to get you back on because we did a really great two-part interview around about 4 years ago now. And I will put the links into that into the description for people to go back and revisit, where we really go deep into a lot of things. But you've got a very interesting and incredible background in, you know, working in some of these psychiatric hospitals and wards and all this stuff. You know, with all your qualifications, it's really great that although you have that background, you do have this kind of spidey sense, sixth sense, which has helped you learn about these entities and how they manipulate people. And so just for people that may have missed those interviews, where did it start for you and how did you get into it and how did you start realizing that, you know, what these things that people were dealing with were, well, not, they are of this world, but maybe not of this dimension.
No, they're not of this dimension for sure. You know, they're from the energy dimension, which John Mays says there is no time, there is no space, there is no matter in that dimension. Mm-hmm. So, after I got my master's degree, I went to work in one of the biggest psychiatric hospitals on the planet. There were like 10,000 patients there when I got there, and nothing in college prepared me for that place. I mean, nothing. And it wouldn't have prepared anybody much for the front lines unless they were in, you know, school counseling or something like that. But, you know, on the front lines, the psychiatric front lines dealing with these people, and especially in that place, it was like, I was totally unprepared for what I was facing there. And, you know, but I was fascinated with abnormal psychology, and this place was chock full of it. It was like, I was also a adrenaline addict. So, it was a perfect place for me. I mean, here's all this pathology, but nowhere in college and in undergraduate or graduate school did they say what caused this stuff. They just described it. Yeah. It was like, okay, if they described it in detail enough, it made it look like they knew what was going on, but they didn't. They didn't.
They just describe it as like mental illness, don't they?
Well, you got the whole DSM, what is it, 7 now? That Bible of psychiatry. You know, okay. People don't know what that is. Even students going into undergraduate and graduate school don't know where that came from. It's completely made up by a group of 10 psychiatrists who took a whole band of abnormal or normal behavior and turned it into pathology. You know, so it's these detailed descriptions of mental illness with numbers and sub directories. And you open it up, it looks very official. I mean, it looks like they know what they're talking about.
They put all the long words in, don't they?
They put a lot of psychobabble in there, you know, a lot of stuff that a lot of people wouldn't understand. And it's all broken up into categories with subdirectories and sub. It really looks official. The thing is, it only describes behavior.
Mm-hmm.
It just describes abnormal behavior. That's all it does. It doesn't say anything about how to cure it. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, they do not know how to cure mental illness.
Mm-hmm.
They have no idea. They don't even know what it is. You know, the back in 1910, the Carnegie Foundation and who was it? Wasn't the Rothschilds? It was another one of those guys. They took over the mental health or the whole medical system with the Flexner Report. So it was the Carnegie Foundation and the Rockefeller Group. Okay, now. These guys are the guys who kind of own the pharmaceutical industry. So they bribe Congress like they always do to pass a law sponsoring the infamous Flexner Report, which said that no college or university could graduate medical doctors unless they were teaching pharmaceutical medicine.
Mm.
Okay. So it had to be centered around their drugs
right.
In order for them to train and graduate doctors. And that knocked out everything. I mean, it knocked out virtually most of the universities in the United States. They had to switch their curriculums in order to legally license doctors. And doctors who did graduate, if they taught anything else, you know, naturopathy or any of the stuff Tesla was doing, or all those guys were labeled quacks. And if these doctors attempted to practice any of that, yoga, meditation, any of that, their licenses were at risk, kind of like YouTube now.
Yeah.
It's like, so what do we have now? We have a mental health system with more drugs than have ever existed, more psychiatric drugs that have ever existed anywhere on the planet. You know, and look at what we got. I mean, you know, last year it was like 47,000 people in the United States killed themselves, committed suicide.
Wow.
You know, 50,000 died in Vietnam. But this is year after year after year. You know, close to 50,000 people are killing themselves every year in the United States.
Yeah.
You know, between 1999 and 2019, the suicide rate increased 33%. You know. Suicide or schizophrenics are killing themselves at a rate of 3 to 5% above the general population. And those drugs that they feed these people don't cure anything.
No.
All they do, they're just tranquilizers. They just dumb them down. They don't get rid of the voices. They don't cure anything. they have no idea what causes schizophrenia. You know, they fake like they do, and they started like with blaming mothers. Okay. But you could observe that, you know, then they moved it up into genetics, which we couldn't observe that until some honest geneticists said, hey, there is no genetic link, you know, so they had to come up with something else that people couldn't examine, you know, so they're moving it from where you could examine it, you know, to places where you can't examine it. And only a small portion of the population of researchers would take a look at it. So it removes it from the observation of schizophrenia and what causes schizophrenia from the vast majority of the populace and puts it up in these small segments of, you know, researchers. So recently, they 10 years ago, Eli Lilly, when they came out with Prozac, said, oh, well, mental illness is a chemical imbalance because, you know, our Prozac somehow does something to the serotonin and makes these people feel better somewhat, you know, so it must be a chemical imbalance. So then they pushed this chemical imbalance theory for all mental illnesses. And that lasted for probably 10 years. They got away with it before some honest researchers came along and said, we don't see a chemical imbalance, you know. And, you know, then they found that they were doing autopsies of these long-term schizophrenics who were using their drugs, and they found that their brains were shrunk like walnuts.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. So they when that was released, Big Pharma and the psychiatric mafia went nuts. You know, no, it's not our drugs. It's the schizophrenia doing this. You know, it's like blame it. They don't even know what schizophrenia. You know, all they see is the behavioral manifestations. They have no idea what causes it. None. Zero.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's an energetic disorder.
Yes.
You know, it's got to do with the mind, which is, they can't measure the mind. They can't measure the spirit. You know, they can't measure thoughts. Now, even though they say it's a thought disorder, they move it away from that. You know, it is a thought disorder. That's the closest they ever come to finding, identifying what it really is. So
they want to keep people in the five senses, don't they? They don't want people thinking. They want people to think that everything's physical. You know, sight, sound, hearing, taste. Anything outside of that is a no-go. They don't want people exploring energy and, you know, consciousness and everything like that.
No. And you could, it's not working. I mean, none of their drugs cure anything. They just tamp down symptoms. So psychology and psychiatry are only concerned with behavior. That's it. And we're spiritual beings.
Absolutely.
You know, if the spirit leaves, we're dead. We're gone. You know, your thoughts are energy. You know, your memory is energy. You know, schizophrenia is these are energetic beings, these voices, these people hear. So, you know, you look at what they're doing. You know, 100,000 Americans are diagnosed with schizophrenia every year. You know, so all these mental illnesses, they went from, 97, you know, when it started off to, I don't know what it was in the 60s. And right now it's approaching 300 illnesses that this Bible of theirs that they created. And it's virtually made up. You know, this body of 10 psychiatrists get together and they vote on these mental illnesses.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's they vote them in, they vote them out, you know. So Dr. Julian Whitaker, he summed it up pretty well. He said, every single one of these mental illnesses were fabricated by breaking up segments of human behavior and pathologizing them. There are no blood tests. There are no lab tests. There's no x-rays. There's no EEGs. There's no test to validate a single one of these diagnoses in that manual. You know, they're just classes of behaviors that a group of psychiatrists have voted to be mental disorders. So they vote them in, they vote them out. You know, who was this? It was Network Against Psychiatric Assault says the DSM-5 labels almost all human emotion as mental illness. A child who talks back, a man who spends too much time on the internet, a woman who grieves the death of her husband or child for more than 2 weeks are all labeled as mentally ill and told they need to be drugged. Unhappiness is labeled as depression, and people are encouraged to numb themselves with drugs instead of the life dealing with the life situations that cause their unhappiness. Over two-thirds of the psychiatrists who wrote the DSM-5 have financial ties to the drug industry. So they vote in these disorders that they think they can, that the big pharma can come up with some kind of drug to treat, and those pass, you know.
It's such a wide umbrella now, though, isn't it? Like, you hear it so often, like mental illness, that term. Like, it's almost like anything, like what you're reading out there, anything can get put under that umbrella. And
oh,
of
yeah.
course, the go-to solution is always the pharmaceutical drugs, right?
Well, no, they'd have no solutions. Those drugs don't cure anything.
Yeah.
You know? Well, now, look at some of these diagnoses that they threw in there. Mathematics disorder. Caffeine intoxication disorder.
I think I've got mathematics disorder.
I'm afraid of mathematics. But sibling relational disorder. So if siblings are fighting with others, it's a relational disorder.
That's
sexual orientation disturbance, homosexuality.
Right.
Now get these. Florence syndrome, being overwhelmed by beauty, such as in Florence, Italy. Fainting and dizziness are the symptoms. The treatment is antidepressants.
Oh, of course. You don't want to be too happy.
Paris syndrome. Mostly Japanese patients visiting France. Symptoms include depression, anxiety, feelings of persecution. You know, before the DSM, they would have called it cultural shock. You know?
That's crazy.
Yeah. In 1952, there were 106 psychiatric disorders. In 1980, there were 256. Now, 297. There's no scientific proof for any of them. And they treat this in the college and the medical schools as if it's the Bible.
Yeah.
You know, they hand it out and they make you memorize it. They make you memorize the classes and what they mean, and they give you tests on it. And this is all fabricated. It's all freaking made up by these bozos up there.
Yeah.
They use it to document for insurance claims. They have to have, you know, schizophrenia 3.90 something, da 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 da, and these sub things, and they use it. They use it for insurance claims.
Yeah.
You know, they use it to label people, and it does not describe people. It describes a specific class of behavior. It's sick what they're doing.
Yeah.
I mean, and the money they're making off of these diagnoses are crazy. The antidepressant market is expected to hit 15.98 by 2023. This is billion, 15.98 billion. And these drugs don't cure depression.
No.
You know, global antipsychotic sales. This is the drugs that shrink the brain and rot out the peripheral nervous system if you use them long enough.
Sorry to interject there, but I've been around people that are on antidepressants, and it's almost like they don't feel anything. It's like at times when they're supposed to feel sad or angry or happy, that it's like it just nulls everything. It's quite sad, really.
Yeah, it is. It just dumbs them down, and it does the same thing with schizophrenics, you know, and the antipsychotic sales worldwide. I mean, this is a worldwide scam that these drugs cure anything. 14.54 billion in 2021, expected to reach 15.5 billion by 2022. Yeah. So what these are major tranquilizers that they just dumb the person down. They virtually turn them into zombies, you know.
So what made you, because you came from this background, this medical background, and you went through all the, let's
brainwashing.
Call it the brainwashing. You got your brain washed.
I got my brain washed.
You got your brain washed. So at what point did the old ticker start going and you were starting to think, hang on a minute, something's not quite right with what I'm being told here and what I'm seeing?
Well, that was quite early. It was in undergraduate psychology. Okay. So here they are feeding us with all this stuff, you know, learn all this stuff, regurgitate it back to us. You know, you'll get a mark on your test, treating it as if it were the truth.
Yeah.
And I was very suspicious of all authority figures going into college. And I look in the back of these manuals, or these books, and it's like, this guy got this information from this guy who got it from this guy who got it from this guy who got it from that guy who got it. Was like intellectual incest.
Yeah.
And it was almost like if enough of them endorse and print the same stuff, it becomes real.
Right. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So at that point, I'm like, you know, and they didn't give us any access to a clinical population at all. You couldn't get into a mental hospital. You couldn't get into a mental health center. You couldn't work in the student counseling center. They cut you off from any access, and the institutions themselves would cut you off to any access. Matter of fact, in the close to 40 years I've been working in these psychiatric institutions, all levels of them, mental health centers, psychiatric hospitals, mental health centers, emergency rooms, the whole gamut. Throughout, you know, that they have in the U.S., I haven't seen one researcher anywhere on the front lines of any of those institutions ever. They wouldn't let them in. You know, oh, we can't risk the danger of allowing you into these institutions. We can't. There's too much insurance risk. We can't account. They won't let them in. You try to get into a prison to try to study schizophrenics or mental illness or anything else. No, you're not going to get in. And same thing with psych hospitals. They won't let you in. Matter of fact, I was talking to one nurse when she was doing her internship. They told her not to even look at these people. Well, when you get on the psych ward, they're so dangerous. Don't even look at them. Don't look them in the eye. Make sure you don't make eye contact. I mean, it's so bizarre what they're doing.
You know what's interesting about that, Jerry? Like you, I've got a bit of a sadistic personality in that I'm fascinated by all this dark stuff and, you know, these mind schisms and everything like that. But quite often when you hear, like, in these murder documentaries or where someone is going to be raped or something like that, the murderer or the rapist will often say, don't look at me, don't look at my eyes. And sometimes people report them of actually turning black, which is obviously that.
I've heard that a number of times.
Yeah.
I've actually seen it. I've experienced it.
Yeah.
So that was my first inkling was the way they kept us away from clinical populations. There's nowhere. The only thing you could check out was experimental psychology in the rat lab. You can go there and you can actually watch these reinforcement schedules work. You know, even in the master's degree, they finally gave us access to prisoners in a prison, but they weren't mental prisoners. They were just regular prisoners, you know? So they won't let students, they won't let researchers in on the front lines to look at these people. So while I was in undergraduate school, I remember they in abnormal psychology, they ordered us to read a paper written by a clinical psychologist, which said if two crazy people had the same delusion, so both of them thought they were Macron and they met, one of them would have to give way and change his delusion. And I'm like, why would that have to happen? I mean, they're both nuts. Why would one of them have to change to something else? You know, and here's this guy wrote this big fancy paper in APA format and looked all, you know, all fancy and met all the writing parameters for this kind of stuff. And 8 years fast forward, when I was on the psychiatric hospital, I was doing my rounds on the second floor, and I saw a new patient I hadn't seen before, and he's carrying on this conversation with somebody, and I there was nobody he was talking to. He's just walking around carrying on this conversation. So I kind of crept up as close as I could get to him from behind, and I'm listening. I couldn't hear exactly what he was saying, but it was like one side of a telephone conversation. You know, and he was talking in complete sentences. And of course, psychiatry would say he was hallucinating because there wasn't anybody he was directly speaking to. But these were complete paragraphs and complete sentences. You know, it wasn't word salad like I was led to believe in college, you know, where they're just babbling incoherently. And these are hallucinations. That no, he was carrying on a coherent conversation with somebody I couldn't see who it is. I couldn't hear who it was. And he caught me, you know, so I'm standing behind him and he turns around and I said, I haven't seen you before. Are you new? He said, yeah. And I said, what's your name? And he said, I'm Jesus Christ. And I looked at him in the eye. I said, no, I'm Jesus Christ. You know, so I'm going, okay, let's see what happens here. Yeah. So that was, I held that in the back of my mind for like 8 years, you know, waiting for the chance to check this out. And he kind of cocks his eyes and he looks up. And he thinks about it a minute. He looks me in the eye and he goes, okay, we can both be Jesus Christ. And he struts off. And I went, okay, so what else have they lied to me about? You know, right away, it's like, yeah. So while I'm working there, everybody was brainwashed to believe that these voices these people were hearing were hallucinations. They didn't think anything more above it about it. They didn't want to know what they were being told, you know, what they were, how they behaved. They didn't want to know anything about it. It was like, they're hallucinations. We already know what they are. They're not worth anything else, you know, and that's what the universities are teaching without having done one iota of research on these things at all.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the psychiatric high priest go, we hereby declare, and the pharmaceutical industry come up behind. Yeah, we agree. These are hallucinations. The only thing you could do is take drugs for them.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? So they teach it in the universities because the universities have been taken over by, you know, big pharma.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so they teach what they teach what big pharma said they need to teach. And anybody who tries to publish anything against big pharma is going to have a hard time getting anything published. Anybody who supports big pharma is going to just breeze right through. They have all the journals and all that kind of, they're going to just make it right through. So I was curious. I mean, nobody knew what these things were saying. So I started asking these patients, what are these voices telling you? Because I saw a one-to-one correspondence between their behavior and them getting in trouble and they're listening to these voices. So it took about a year and a half to figure out how to talk to them about them because they were extremely gun shy. If they talked to a psychiatrist about the voices or they talked to a psych nurse or a counselor, the counselor would report it to the psychiatrist. The psychiatrist would increase their drugs and turn them into zombies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they didn't want any trouble out of them. So, you know, it was interesting that they pretty much ignored the voices until the patient was telling somebody that the voices were telling them to kill themselves. If a psychiatrist heard that, man, he moved like somebody poked him in the butt with a hot poker. You know, he locked that person down, increased their drugs, put them on suicide watch. They didn't want them suiciding on their watch because that looked bad for them. You know, so all of a sudden the voices became real. You know, oh, the voices are telling them to do this. We better do something about it. You know, you talk about schizophrenic behavior. And they didn't even realize it. You know, it was like, so I'm watching these guys, the psychiatrist, and I was sitting in the office with one of my clients and a psychiatrist, and then the patient was complaining about the voices. And the psychiatrist told him, well, okay, I'll increase your meds. Just ignore the voices. They're hallucinations.
Just ignore.
You know, and I called that guy back a week later just out of curiosity, and I pulled him in my office. And I said, well, the psychiatrist told you to ignore your voices. I said, how's that going? He said, not good. Mm. He said, they get louder. Yeah. So then I started asking all the other psychotics on my caseload, what happens when you ignore the voices? Every single one of them said, they get louder. They won't be ignored.
Interesting.
That is now a pattern, you know? So I've started seeing these patterns, you know? One of the patterns was that they were consistently negative. You know, they weren't random. You know, it was a consistently negative. They weren't like good, bad, neutral. You know, they didn't run any range. They were consistently negative. What held them on a consistently negative pattern? Why weren't they random? You know, that was the first thing, like, you know, what's going on here? You know, I didn't know at the time, you know. I didn't believe in demons and all that kind of stuff. You know, another pattern I saw was, even though the psychiatrists are telling everybody and the universities are telling everybody that this is a biochemical imbalance in their brain, I never ever saw a psychiatrist give any kind of baseline lab to find out what neurotransmitters in the brain were out of balance by how much, you know, never. So how do they know what they're treating and what they're doing? You know, how do they know what's out of balance by how much and which one? There's like 23, I think, neurotransmitters in the brain. Which one is out of balance and how by how much? I mean, they're telling everybody it's a chemical imbalance. That's what they're treating, teaching in the colleges and the universities, the medical schools. You know, where's their proof? You know, why are they treating this when they don't know what they're treating? You know, and I'm like, so I asked one of them, I said, well, what's the baseline? How do you know what's out of balance by how much? The guy said, oh, the pharmaceutical industry takes care of that for us. They tell us which drugs to give her. And I'm like thinking, you let the fox in the hen house, man. What are you thinking? You know, and that's what they're doing. They just follow what the drug industry says. They put the drug industry puts out all this. Hey, we got a new antipsychotic drug. Da, 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 da. Yeah, try this. It has less side effects. Da, da, da. You know, they're, oh, yeah, we'll try it. You know, so they're just using the population as guinea pigs for the drug industry. You know, they got away with that for over a decade. You know, now more ethical researchers did the research and they said, we can't find a biochemical imbalance. We don't find any genetic markers, you know? So they lost that, but they're still pushing it. If you look at their drug advertisements now, it's like, oh, it is believed or it is suspected that, you know, schizophrenia is caused by a chemical imbalance of the brain. No, it's not. It's caused by the voices. Now, the more I studied these voices, the more patterns that started appearing, you know. So the next one was anti-religious. You know, I had psych patients coming to me telling me, hey, they don't like the Bible. You know, they don't like me going to church. They get louder when I go to church. You know, when I recite the 23rd Psalm, one guy said it's like the voices reacted like worms thrown on a hot frying pan. You know, so I'm like, why would a hallucination care about church? Why would a hallucination care about the Bible? You know, why would a hallucination go nuts if somebody recited the 23rd Psalm? You know, so I started seeing these patterns appear. You know, now if they're running patterns, they can't be hallucinations. Hallucinations don't run patterns.
Yeah.
You know, so pattern after pattern after pattern. Over time, you know, so what we're talking about here is an energetic attack. So your mind is energetic, you know, your spirit is energetic, your thoughts are energetic. These things are thoughts. They come through the patient as thoughts. Now, they're not their thoughts, but they act like they're their thoughts. They want them to believe that they're their thoughts. So they're being inserted in the patient's thought stream to tell them to do this, to do that, to these, and a lot the patients struggle with that. So how do I tell the difference between my own thoughts and these entities, these voices? Mm-hmm. Okay, so these things are energetic, you know. So they're you can't see energy. You can't see a magnetic field. You know, you can't see it. You can't feel it. You can't taste it. Gravity. You can't see it, you can't feel it, you can't taste it. You only see it by the effects it has on the physical environment. Okay? So if you get a bottle of iron filings and you put it on a magnet, then you can see the outline of the magnetic field. Well, it's the same thing with these voices. These are energetic beings. They're negative energetic beings. Mm-hmm. They're also parasites. They drain the person of their energy, but they run patterns. So these patterns that I'm going to read you are the physical manifestation of what these things are. Okay, so they're equivalent to the magnetic field and the iron filings. Okay, so they're negative, they're anti-religious, they foster and create negative emotion, they feed off of that negative emotion, they energetically drain their victims. Okay, so after the patient is attacked by these voices, their energy level drops to nothing. And you ask them, did you use that energy? No, I wasn't exercising. I was tossing and turning in bed all night. But yet they're so drained they can't even get up for breakfast. These things get louder after sunset. Now, another interesting thing that you might keep your attention on is these patterns that I'm reading you are the same patterns that the mainstream media is feeding us right now and all throughout the pandemic. I mean, the mainstream media was broadcasting these same things: negativity, anti-religion, negative emotion. You can't ignore them. They took over the airwaves. They were coming at you from all directions. They foster isolation. They foster self-destructive behavior. They demand the attention of their victims. They maneuver for increased control over their victims. They gaslight. They manipulate perception. They have complete access to the schizophrenic's memory, because memory is energetic also. Okay? So they can go in there and they can pull up every rotten memory that that patient has, and they can rub it in their face until they lower their vibration into they get depressed and down to their own vibration. It's only then that they can take the energy. They can't take the energy when they're feeling good or they're feeling positive. So they demand that the victim not tell anybody about their presence. You know, it's kind of like the mainstream media hiding behind everything, like don't tell anybody that the propaganda that we're putting out. They're consummate liars. They lie about everything. You can't trust anything these voices are saying. You can't make bargains with them. They won't keep them. They consistently steer their victim away from anything that might generate joy. They can manipulate feeling without speaking. I mean, these guys could be sitting there doing okay 1 minute, and all of a sudden they just feel awful. They short circuit reason, which gets these guys in a lot of trouble. They try to pass themselves off as the patient's own thoughts, and they sound like them. Matter of fact, a lot of patients I had at the state hospital, they'd ask the voices, "Who are you? What are you?" They would say, "We are you." So they want the patient or the schizophrenic to believe that those thoughts that they're putting in the patient's head are who they are, that they belong to them. And we're told from the time we're born, any thought that comes into your head belongs to you. That's far from true. That's far from true. And everybody's experienced this. You're walking down the sidewalk, minding your own business, and then all of a sudden you get this horrendous thought, like, jump in front of that bus, or if you're standing on a bridge, well, what would it be like to jump? Or, it's stuff that you would never think on your own. It doesn't belong to you. It's so adverse to who you normally are that it shocks you. Those thoughts come from them. Okay. They foster selective forgetting. So if you give these schizophrenics exercises to do to fight the voices, if they don't write them down, by the time you're done speaking to them, they won't remember a single one of them. They fill the mind with negative thoughts about self and others. They don't want you to have any positive relationships. They don't want you to have a girlfriend. They hate relationships. They want to break up all positive relationships. They'll tell the man that the woman's cheating on them. They'll tell the woman the man's cheating on them. They'll do anything they can to break up relationships. They destroy positive self-concept. They attempt to pull their victim away from consensual reality. So then the reality that we normally function in every day, the patient might be walking down the sidewalk and they see somebody and they go, "That guy's following me." Or some people start laughing and the voices tell them they're laughing at you. They use confusion as a means of instilling negative suggestions. They are averse to anything positive and beautiful. They don't want these people going to parks. They don't want them watching anything beautiful, sunsets, that kind of stuff. They get very upset. And I saw this in the emergency room. I had to be very careful there too, because it was dominated by psychiatrists. Okay. And I'd gotten trouble twice in the state hospital for when psychiatrists found out I was asking patients about what these voices were and what they were telling the patients. I was pulled up into their office and given the riot act, saying, "You will not do that. These voices are hallucinations. Everybody knows that."
Yes. Get back on track. with the program.
Get with the program. And it's like you're making the patients worse by asking them questions about the hallucinations. What you're doing is reinforcing their hallucinations. And I'm thinking, yeah, you freaking moron. You don't even know what you're talking about. But boy, you couldn't tell one of them that, you know.
Of course.
So they want to render the victim useless. So they're useless to society and themselves and everybody else. They hate and they torment babies. They hate babies. You know, they hate children.
That's interesting. You see often with these like ghost videos that the baby in the cot is got, you know, getting all this interference. And I don't know if you've seen any of those videos, but it does seem to be that I think children and babies, their frequency is naturally higher. And so that's like not good for them.
No, it's not. No, they want to bring that down. Matter of fact, I had one patient that I was working with. He said he went on, what is that one they tried to ban, where they have these short clips?
TikTok.
No, it's not Peacock. It's
TikTok.
TikTok.
Yeah.
TikTok. He said he would go onto TikTok and look at babies laughing. He said it tormented his voices so bad it drove them crazy.
Really?
And I said, that's interesting.
Yeah.
You know, so they don't want them watching anything spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so there's a lot of things you can do to fight back against these things. And you know that too, because you've walked them out of the people.
Yeah.
You know, I've walked them out into the light. But then there's the big ones. I won't mess with them.
Yeah. Yeah. The way I've seen, the way down the years, I've seen, I think we're all, as you mentioned there, we're all subject to entity attachments, but some people have more than others, and some people have more stronger attachments than others that can be more problematic. And, you know, the case in point is the schizophrenics that, you know, have got a very strong attachment that is kind of running the show for them, I would say. I would use those words. And when it comes to like murderers and people like that, I would say that the entity is literally almost fully hosting that person to the point where the person isn't really a human. It's a demon incarnate in a human body. And I think that's what we're really dealing with here on this planet, which is, it's incredible when you think about it.
Yeah, all these mass shootings and stuff, you know. And you know, I've talked to prisoners in the prison who committed some heinous act, and they said, I don't remember doing it.
Mm.
Because they didn't do it. The voices took them over and did it.
Yeah.
You know, and these horrendous you know, shootings, these murders, and it's coming to a boil right now because there's a massive spiritual battle going on this planet right now, and it is just boiling over. Stuff is coming to the surface that has never surfaced before for people to see. And you know, the high priests, you know, they're just drugging people senseless. I mean, they're after the kids now. I mean, the drugging of the kids is incredible. There's as of 2017, and there's a lot more now. There's over 1 million children in the U.S. under the age of 6 on psychiatric drugs. There's over 622,000. Now, this is 2017 figures. It's much higher right now, much higher. Over 622,000 under the age of 5 are on psychiatric drugs. 80,000, over 80,000 are on ADHD drugs, which are amphetamines. Okay. And I've run into a bunch of prisoners in the prison who started off on these drugs and just kept going and going and going until the Ritalin or the Adderall wasn't enough and they moved to meth. And then they ended up getting thrown in prison because of their behavior. Over 38,000 children are on antidepressants right now. Over 85,000 are on antipsychotics. Now, these are the drugs that rot your brain out. They got them on with kids. They're putting kids on these things. They turn kids into zombies. You know, over 389,000 are on anti-anxiety drugs. You know, this is nuts. You know, this is nuts what they're doing.
Yeah.
I'd like to take a quick peek at the mental health of the high priests that are running this mental health system of ours, the Western mental health system. So they're pushing them out by the thousands with these fancy diplomas proclaiming they are mental health experts. Okay. So, you you know, they're working with a population, schizophrenics, that have one of the highest suicide rates of any of the mental illnesses. So you might infer that a population with a very high incidence of suicide is a fairly unstable population. So the National Mental Health Institute estimated that 4.9% of people with schizophrenia will die by suicide. Their suicide rate is 5 to 10 times that of the general population. We know they're not stable. Okay. Now you take a look at how the high priests are doing who run our mental health system. According to the Journal of the American Medical Association, the suicide rate for psychiatrists is 65 per 100,000, or 5.9 times higher than that of the general population, and about equal with that of schizophrenics. So their suicide rate is virtually identical to the most seriously mentally ill of the entire population they're dealing with. The Journal of Clinical Psychiatry in 1980 did a 5-year study of 18,730 consecutive physician deaths by suicide and found that psychiatrists suicide regularly year by year at rates more than twice those expected, and that the difference is statistically significant. These are the high priests who run our mental health centers right now. They run the mental health systems. You know, and you look at their popularity among patients, okay? So looking at assault rates overall jobs based on a study of 120,000 assaults from 1987 to 1992, over 5 years, reported the assault rate for all jobs was 12.6 per thousand. The assault rate for doctors other than psychiatrists was 16.2 per thousand. The assault rate for custody staff, these are psychiatric custody staff who are around patients 24 hours a day, or 69 per thousand. The assault rate on psychiatrists for the little bit of time that they spend on these patients, around these patients, according to the American Medical Association, is 65 per thousand, or 5.9 times higher than that of the general population. So they're being assaulted at a rate much, much higher than virtually anybody else in the population.
Incredible. I remember from our last interview, I don't remember the exact story, but I'm sure you do. But I remember when you told it was fascinating that when it was time for the meds, you said that they all acted the same way. The people acted all the same way. Do you remember talking about that? Do you know what I'm talking about with that?
Well, what comes to mind is they would eventually all go off their meds.
Okay. Right. Yeah, that might have been it.
Yeah, they didn't take them. I mean, because they have awful side effects, you know. So after a while, they get tired of dealing. They're toxic side effects.
Mm.
You know, it's the drug is actually poisoning them. Mm. You know, very slowly, but it's also tamping them down.
The voices were telling them not to take the drugs.
Well, I found that out toward the end with one gal. She was in cosmetology school in the psychiatric rehab center I was working in. She'd gone off her drugs 3 times. And that was the limit. They went off their drugs 3 times. Back then, we didn't know anything else about how to treat schizophrenia. Nobody suspected that the voices were negative entities. I mean, I didn't want to believe it, even though I was seeing evidence of it.
Mm.
And it took quite a bit more to bring down my denial system, like a lot more. But we brought this gal in. We're about to discharge her. Her mother found out about it. Her mother called me and begged me not to do that because she couldn't handle him, handle this person. She'd been round and round with her. So I said, okay, come on up and we'll talk to her. And the mother said, we'll figure out why. And so she came up one Friday evening and we brought the girl in. And we're asking her, this is the third time you've been off your drugs. You knew that you were going to get kicked out after the third time. Why did you go off your drugs? And her mother's begging her, tell him, why did you go off your drugs? Both of us are, you know, begging, why did you do this? You shot yourself in the foot. You had a career. You had a job. You know, you were about to get your license. And you blew it up. You just blew it. Why'd you do that? She goes, well, you won't believe me. I said, I've heard a lot of weird things while I've been working here. You know, I don't think you're going to tell me anything that's going to surprise me. So she said, okay. The voices told me not to take it. They told me that the psychiatrist was poisoning me.
Mm.
And they pointed to the side effects as proof that he was poisoning me.
Mm.
And in effect, it's true.
Mm.
You know, those are toxic side effects of the drugs. They're the drugs are somewhat they're toxic.
Mm.
You know, so right away that clicked mind is like, okay, so that's why all these psychiatrists are getting beat up only by schizophrenics. They're not getting beat up by anybody else in the psychiatric population. You know, it's the neurotics aren't beating them up. The bipolars aren't beating them up. You know, it's mostly the psychotics.
Mm.
So, you know, for years, I was trying to, why aren't they taking their drugs? So I did this experiment where, you know, on a 1 to 10 scale kind of thing, like, I was asking what's worst. Then, and I went to the DSM and I copied all the symptoms of a florid psychosis. You know, schizophrenia, all the nasty symptoms. And then all the ones that went off their drugs, I'd bring them in my office. I'd say, I want you to write down all the reasons you went off your drugs, you know, and what side effects you had. And, you know, the reason was basically the side effects. And I said, what side effects did you have? Because they all didn't have the same side effects. You know? So they'd write down, you know, 4 or 5 side effects that were awful. And then I'd give them the two sheets back. The one with all the psychotic symptoms and their side effects. I said, which one of these is worse? Every single one of them said the symptoms of schizophrenia was much worse than the side effects. This went on for 3 friggin' years. And when I asked them, why did you go off your medicines? Every single one of them said, I don't know. The answer came with that one gal. That was the 7th year I was at the state hospital. Then things, it was like all these little pieces of the puzzle then clicked together at that point. Why yeah. Psychiatrists were getting beat up over everybody else. You know, psych nurses weren't getting beat up. Psychologists weren't getting beat up. Counselors weren't getting beat up. Chaplains weren't getting, nurses weren't getting beat up. It was psychiatrists.
Mm.
You know, what just popped to mind is the true story. Okay. What they taught us in college was schizophrenics are too disorganized to do complex planning. You know, I believe that. That was the stuff they put down in the stuff you had to memorize. So one day I got a call from a friend of mine who was doing, you know, had the same job I did in a different unit. He said, you know, come on over here. You got to see this. And he said, hurry up, you know, before they clean it up. I said, well, okay. So I ran over there. And he took me to the psychiatrist's office. So this psychiatrist was very unique in his building. This guy acted like Sigmund Freud, dressed like Sigmund Freud, smoked a pipe like Sigmund Freud, had a kind of smoking jacket like Sigmund Freud, and acted like Sigmund Freud, you know, very, very hooty. I mean, I looked at him and I'm like, what planet did this guy come from? You know? So they didn't have the highest quality psychiatrist at the institutions there. And, you know, we went into his office, and here was this load of crap right smack in his middle of his desk, shaped into a pipe. So what had happened is one of the patients on the third floor who he had just drugged mercilessly, okay, got pissed off, somehow snuck down 3 flights of stairs past 3 nursing stations, got to the first floor, broke into his office without making any noise, crawled up onto his desk and crapped right in the middle of his desk, shaped it into a pipe, and then escaped from the hospital, and they never caught him again.
My God, that's crazy.
There were a lot of crazy things happened there.
I imagine every day was interesting. I mean, I find that with what I do, you know, just some of the stories you hear. And, you know, one thing I talk about on my channel is, you know, how these entities are masqueraders.
Oh, yeah.
I work with one guy, and I've told this story several times, but it's good for context to tell it again, that thought he was dealing with his dead dad, his deceased dad, and this entity was giving him all this information because they know us, right?
Right. They can pull up any information out of your mind that you have there, because they're energetic, your memory's energetic. They can go in there and pull up every rotten thing you've ever done.
Yeah. So this guy was getting all this information about himself, and this
it was accurate.
Yeah, this entity was saying, "I'm your dad, you know, I'm still around you, don't worry." So this guy was following all the information that he was being told to do by this voice. He ended up losing his job, his wife, he nearly ended up dying, right? And this is what, you know, triggers a lot of people in my messages is that these entities, they'll mask themselves that whatever your flavor is, whatever your favorite flavor is, they'll mask themselves to that. I mean, you said it right at the start. That guy said that I'm Jesus, right?
Right.
And so they don't care what you believe in, as long as you believe in something, and then they'll show up in that form.
Yeah, I'm Jesus Christ, or I'm your guardian angel, or I'm your spirit guide.
Absolutely.
You know? And they suck a lot of people in on that spirit guide thing. You know, and once they let them in, they're in.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. They're connected. It's almost like there's an energetic cord between the entity
right.
and that person.
Once you let them in, that, you know, Ouija boards are extremely dangerous. They are not toys.
No.
I've dealt with a lot of patients who have gone psychotic after using Ouija boards.
Mm-hmm.
You know, meth is another one.
Yeah.
You know, the prisoners called it the devil's drug.
Yeah,
and that's fairly insidious, because it makes you feel, you know, so good. You know, you're high and you're powerful and you've got tons of energy, and you know, and then they start hearing the voices for a while they're on meth, and that may go on for a month, 2, 3, 4, 5 months, where when they come back down, the voices disappear, and then one day they don't.
Yeah,
they're there forever, and that person is now as psychotic as any of the ones in the state hospital.
Yeah,
meth is an extremely dangerous drug.
Well, we haven't even spoken about alcohol. I mean, alcohol is ingrained in society. You know, it's everywhere. I mean, I'm here in Mexico. It's deep in the culture. I'm from the UK. It's deep in the culture there. You know, you get married, you get drunk. You finish your work for the day, you get drunk. It's a weekend, you get drunk. What does that do? It opens you up to these.
Yeah, it has its own spirit and I don't know how many times I've heard that. They hang around bars and wait for people to get drunk enough, and then they jump in there and they take over the drinking. So it's not just the guy who's drinking. It's all these spirits who can't get drunk in their spiritual form, and they need a body to get drunk in.
Absolutely. And that's why people, when they the morning after, the person will say to God, "You were like a totally different person last night when you were drunk." Well, that's because the person's become hosted by the entity. And you know, it just, people don't want to hear that because people like to drink, but this is the information that's true, I believe.
Well, you look at building up to a drink, you know, these guys are having, and what they say is, you know, with drug addicts and alcoholics, that entity never leaves your auric field. It's always there taunting you. Oh, you can have one drink, or you can go to the bar to talk to your friends and not drink, or you know, so what they call it, building up to a drink. So it's all these little steps where that entity gets you to move closer and closer to drinking.
Yeah, you know, just have one.
Just have one, or you can go by the bar and just kind of look in the window, or you know.
But another thing I want to point out, which was interesting, which again crosses over with what I've found in my work, is that they don't want you doing anything that's going to, I don't know, like raise your frequency to the point, you touched on it earlier, where they don't even want you to go for a walk in the woods or down the beach, because they don't like nature. You know, when we go outside, we feel better. You know, we connect with nature. They don't like that. And I've noticed sometimes that, you know, sometimes I'll think about going to the beach and then something will be like, "Oh, no, just stay and do some more work." And I'm like, "Hang on a minute." No, I'm going to the beach.
Right, right.
So
yeah, you got to pay attention to your thoughts. What's coming into your head?
Yeah, absolutely.
Because they don't all belong to you. They don't belong to you.
They don't. They want you all around Wi-Fi, and they want it around electromagnetic frequencies that are completely probably toxic for us all. I think that these frequencies now with the 5, you know what, the Wi-Fi and everything like that, I think that that makes it easier for them to interface with this dimension, and we are more subject to more of them interfering with us right now. So they've done something planetary to make that interface easier. So yeah, you're absolutely right. The voices in our heads are a lot of the time not all of our own. So
Swedenborg says that he's a Christian mystic that lived 300 years ago. He said that none of your thoughts are your own. They either come in from the good side or the bad side, but you're the decider. You're the one who decides which ones you're going to act on and which ones you're not. You know, so it's like what the Indian said, you feed, you know, whichever wolf you feed is the one that grows.
Yeah, absolutely. Jerry, we're going to have to wrap it up there, unfortunately. I could talk to you all day about this stuff. We've got so much crossover with the information that we share. I think it was really good to do this again. So where can people find you? Where's the best place people can find you?
Well, they can find me at jerrymarzinsky.com. It's Marzinsky. Also, Sherry and I published this book, An Amazing Journey Through the Psychotic Mind. This will tell you about how we came to the conclusion that these entities are entities and they're not hallucinations, and gives you some suggestions of how you can fight back against them. You can get that at it's on Amazon, and it's in German, it's in French, it's in Spanish, and lulu.com is another place you can get it.
Right. Well, I'll put all of Jerry's links in the description below. But yeah, once again, thanks for coming on, Jerry. And we'll speak again, I'm sure.
Okay, glad to have me.